This university was even approached by passage maker. The university had been trying to work out where the language center should sit. We had been in the Faculty of Humanities, and then we were moved into being a central service. We got moved around. They could never quite decide where to put us. The biggest shift came when they took the MA away from the language center and put it into the School of Education. They also moved all languages other than English into a school of modern languages, and we were basically left as an English language teaching unit, an ELI. And we were. At that point, we totally became a service, so we were kind of comparable to the library. I think we were a little bit uneasy about becoming a service, but the university didn't change any of our contracts or anything. Pretty much, they carried on as a trimmed down version of what was there before. But it was a crossroads in that those of us who had a foot in both the English language program and the MA in TESOL had to decide where we wanted to be. I chose to stay in the language center because I still wanted to teach EAP. I didn't want to go down to more academic research route and become like a research lecturer. I wanted to stay and do the practical thing side of things. At this point, we were a combination of hourly paid EAP teachers and a small number of full-time faculty, but we were not included in the research assessment exercises. We were considered non-research active faculty. When we first heard that Passagemaker Partnerships was talking to the university, we didn't know anything about it. But we did know these types of discussions were going on because we had heard that the university on the other side of town had been talking to Kaplan, and we pretty much suspected that the education syndicates had been in discussion with Leeds as well. But Passagemaker? Nobody had even heard of them at the time. There really hadn't been much publicity about Passagemaker. Even though they were in talks with other UK universities at the time and already had one partnership up and running. There were long drawn out and heated discussions as we began to learn more, and we fought hard against it. We raised all the concerns that we had about the quality of teaching, dropping, and the type of, you know, the whole idea of profit model and mixing public and private partnerships, the whole works, everything. You know, at the university is exactly the same. It is hilarious. I mean, no, it's not really hilarious because it's an awful process to go through. It was horrible. It was a horrible process to go through. It really was. At the time, we were like, our student numbers were dwindling, and the university had a lot of attention on us because of this focus on internationalization. The international office was supposed to be doing our recruitment. We had no remit to recruit for ourselves. So we were kind of powerless. The international office wasn't delivering students, so, you know, when Passagemaker came along, we were given the choice of, one, do nothing, do it yourself, or go with Passagemaker. And do nothing was not really an option. In other words, if we didn't want Passagemaker to sign up with university, then we needed to have a plan for how we were going to match what was going to happen with them in charge. You know, deliver the number of students they were promising. And there was just no way. We couldn't do it. We had no marketing, and the international office wasn't going to be part of it, so effectively, we had no choice. So then, of course, the partnership agreement was signed, and it was like, well, now, professionally, you have got to make a decision. You have either got to leave, or you can throw yourself into this and see what happens. Because We didn't know what was going to happen, right? It could actually be a good thing. And I stayed and decided that I was going to have a go and see what happened. I could always leave if it didn't work out. Actually, very few left. Very, very few. Before the partnership, we were effectively running like an old school language center in the UK, in the sense that people had a job and then they were expected to do it. Nobody was managed at all. In the UK, everybody was on a scale. So every year, your pay went up the scale. And it wasn't a performance related or anything like that. But what happened after Passage Maker came along was kind of the opposite. We started managing people more closely. And one of the big switches was switching to a, well, in the UK, a 9-to-5 working day. You couldn't just teach your classes and then be off to who knows where. The expectation was that you put in a full working day. And this did not sit well with some who were accustomed to an academic lifestyle. So, yeah, some left. But for the most part, they were ones who had just been coasting along, you know, doing the least that they had to do their jobs, but not really pulling their weight. So there was a culture shift there in terms of how people were managed. But I really saw it as a positive thing. Because I had been running programs before Passage Maker came along, I carried on that role for the most of my time with Passage Maker at Leeds University. I managed a program of support classes. Sorry. For direct entry international students. You know, students who had matriculated but still need the support. It was in the contract that the university paid an at-cost charge to Passage Maker to deliver that program for them. I ran that for several years and I just totally enjoyed it. I was given a lot of freedom, and so that was the first time I had really enjoyed running a program, if you like. It is worth mentioning that the UK Passage Maker centers are different than the ones in the US. In the UK, they are very much pre-university centers. The Passage Maker students aren't yet students of the university. None of the staff are university staff. They are all employed by a joint venture between the university and Passage Maker. The UK Passage Maker centers are effectively a pre-university college that merely exists on campus, if you like. So after a few years of doing that, I was kind of like, I was actually interested in the Leeds Center Director of Academics position. I really felt that I wanted to step up into that position, but there had been somebody appointed a few years before and she wasn't going anywhere. Then somebody told me that there was one being advertised in the United States at RIU. It seemed like a natural step up because I had been managing programs for 10 or 11 years. So I applied for a job. Yeah, it was a competitive RIU appointment, so I wasn't unilaterally moved or just put here by Passage Maker. I had to go through the whole RIU interview process.